Let's sing joyfully about God's amazing grace, his unmerited favor upon wretched sinners like us. Seated.
Rise up, church, with broken wings, fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By his grace again we'll fly. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth.
We'll shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth, he's the Lord of heaven and earth.
The stone that the builders rejected, a rock of refuge where my pride is broken, a sure foundation when the sand is sinking, where we are built upon like living stones. There is no one else like you, there is no one like you, Lord, there is no one else like you, Son of Man and Son of God, Son of to the depths descended. The host of hell conspired to keep you captive, but every chain of sin and death you've broken, and triumph over by almighty power. There is no one else like you. There is no one like you, Lord. There is no one else like you, Son of Man and Son of God, Son of
Son of God.
find rest, my soul.
Thank you, Jim. I hope that is truly a desire of your heart, that you're always hungering for God and the things of God and the message of the cross. Today we're going to do something a little bit different by way of message, and Dave Williams and Eric Wolbert and I had the opportunity to attend a pastor's conference this past week for about two or three days at Parkside Church in Cleveland, Ohio. Eric loved it so much there he hung around to do some work for his business, and but anyway, I'm glad to see you back, Eric. And by the way, he and Dave, you know, they man the ship as far as teaching God's Word in the Bible Hour, and we hope that if you're not coming out at the 9:30 hour, you'll come and sit under the teaching of God's Word. You know, it's vitally important to our church growth. It's vitally important to your personal walk with Christ, and it's an opportunity to really be equipped to do things and face the challenges that you have throughout the week. So we thank the Lord for these men that do this faithfully on Sundays. And so at this ministry, the host was Alistair Begg. I don't know how many have heard of Alistair Begg, but he spent the first 31 years or 32 years of his life in his homeland, Scotland, and then came to the Parkside Church in Cleveland, and has been there. He's about 69 years of age now, but a wonderful expositor of the Word, and loves the Lord, very, very transparent man, a real man you can identify with, you know, in a church that loves Jesus. And I particularly encourage you, if you want to listen in on any of these opportunities you have through the airwaves, you know, Truth for Life is a very good instructional and a practicum to facing the things that you go through in life. But Alistair Begg, he's sound and very, very solid in theology of God's Word. And so, but you know, beyond that, I just give thanks and appreciation for the opportunity to go to these things every once in a while, where people see the bigger vision, not just their own ministry, but care about other people who are church leaders, other people who are out in the fray, you know, doing it in various locations, and they take their ministry and they use it to invest in the lives of people coming alongside to help encourage those who are in ministry. And so that's huge, you know, to those who are in ministry. And like I've told you before, I don't always have the opportunity to sit under the teaching or the preaching of God's Word. But these are times of refreshment and renewal, and just kind of a gut check too, to see if you're doing, you know, what God has called you to do. And so we thank the Lord for these opportunities. Also, anytime, you know, I have the opportunity to do something like that, and I know the guys as well, you know, you pray ahead of time and you ask the Lord, you know, speak to my heart, show me something that I need to hear, something that I need to know. And so we want to share a little bit about what we took away from that conference, and we might overlap a little bit, guys. That's why I'm going first, because I didn't want you to say the things I'm going to say. But anyway, there was a theologian there by the name of John Woodhouse, and he had several of the sessions. We had breakout sessions, too. We could sit in and choose topically what we wanted to line up with or hear about. And have some takeaway as well, but John Woodhouse, a wonderful theologian of God's Word, and I think it was him, might have been Alistair Begg or one of the other guys, but quoted Spurgeon, I believe, and Spurgeon seemed to be a favorite one to quote. But you know, the beauty of God's Word is that all roads lead to Christ, and what I mean by that is basically, from wherever you're reading Scripture, whether the old books of the Old Testament to the New Testament, Christ can be preached from those biblical texts. And the cross must be preached in the church. It is our message And we've been talking about that. I kind of did a little check of my own heart, you know. We were talking about in that conference, you know, from time to time we bring out the cross and this kind of message, you know, at appropriate times of the year. But, you know, we serve a risen Savior. Every Sunday is a celebration of the resurrection. And John Woodhouse was showing us various texts of the Old Testament, very obscure, by the way, in some points, and just showing about the resurrection and paralleling it to the New Testament. And so it was very rich. It was very rewarding to hear that. And there is a scarlet thread that just runs and attaches all of God's Word. And I think that phrase, you know, all roads lead to Christ, I think it was originally all roads lead to Rome or what have you, you know. But all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. And it helps us to understand the Christ eternal, the one who was before all things. And he is preached from the Old Testament. Sometimes we have this paradigm in our thinking, don't we, that Christ and his ministry and his life and all of his existence began, you know, with his earthly birth. Nothing could be further from the truth. And so he is the God of very gods. He was there in creation, as Terry was talking about with the children. So we must always preach the cross of Jesus Christ and not bring the cross out when it's convenient. But everything and every message needs to speak to the message that Jesus is mighty to save. And we preach that. To those who are perishing, the preaching of the cross is foolishness. But to we who are the saved or being saved, it is the power of God unto salvation. To all believe. Nothing else will bring someone from darkness to light. No one else, no other message, no other way, no other hook a church uses or a gimmick or an angle will cause somebody to be born again. It might get someone into the church. It might get someone doing various things as far as the church is concerned. But to see someone redeemed, we must preach the cross. And so that was one takeaway from that conference. Also, you know, they gave us handles and tools, as I was saying with John Woodhouse, to more diligently study God's Word to get to extract the gold that's there. There's so much there, you know, and sometimes we only touch a little bit of that on the surface, and encourage you to be students of the Word. And in a practical sense, too, you know, we were sitting around between the sessions, and not one person of the, I don't know, 1,700 that gathered there, you know, we didn't go away hungry either. The church there did it right. They did it well. This was the 19th conference, I believe, that was held with that there, give or take. And we were kind of sitting around, you know, in between the sessions, and I was just kind of observing the building and looking at people coming and going, there was a group of people that were really involved in kind of behind the scenes. You almost wouldn't notice them, you know, filling the water buckets with water bottles and making sure that everything was there for their guests. And that was all the children of the church. And it was really cool. You know, you might not even notice them. You see these kids kind of flying around. You wonder what they're doing or why they're in there. They had their assignment. They were a part of, and they were made to feel a part of. I think as a church here, we can do a better job at that. Lack of better words, a job. We need to show our children that they're important and that they're a part of the ministry. And if you don't involve them when they're young, you're going to lose them when they're teenagers. The statistics are very much there. We have seen young people come and go, you know, but we need to show them that we love them and they're important to the ministry. They're just not kind of a sideline, if you would. And then Terry does a wonderful job with the kids in junior church as well. So on that note, I just kind of took that away as well. And we're going to chat a little bit more about that. I also checked the message, you know, that I shared with you last Sunday, the shepherd's focus. And it really paralleled a lot of what was being expressed and themed at that conference. And I was very thankful for that. Just to kind of give you an overview without getting into this message again, the Apostle Paul kind of in Scripture as we were talking about last week, really gives us an example of how he went about shepherding. His work kind of was observable and viewable, and it set an example of how to shepherd the church well. And I told you last week that the onus is on the church leadership to shepherd well. The Apostle Peter was given instruction 3 times by the Lord to feed my sheep. And that was after, you know, denial. That was after his rejection of even knowing the Christ. And so he was told to shepherd the flock, and then in turn he told his fellow elders that they needed to, in 1 Peter, to shepherd the flock that was among them. So there's a great responsibility for those who are in church leadership to not only shepherd the flock, but to understand what a shepherd does. And Paul really exemplifies how to go about that. And I shared that with you last week because Paul warned those who he spent time with, those he didn't, but just by way of letter as well. When I'm not with you or these communications aren't before you, there will be those among you that will rise up, and they are wolves in sheep clothing, and they will manipulate Scripture to spiritually abuse you and do it in the name of Christ, and you might not even realize that that is going on. And so you need to be a student of God's Word, studying the Word to show yourself approved, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed. So knowing the Word, and I shared with you last week the statement that Frank always made, you know, was basically, you know, I'm not ever going to be deceived. And the Bible does say the very elect of God can be deceived. So don't think that you have a corner on the market. The way you're not deceived is by studying the Word of God. And this was the communication of the Apostle Paul in the book of Acts, the 20th chapter. I'm not going to get into that in depth because I want to give the guys an opportunity to share as well. But in that, he shepherded doctrinally. That means another word for doctrine is to teach. And so his thrust was to teach the Christ, the rule of Christ among God's people. And that is what has been entrusted to church leadership, the rule of Christ, the whole counsel of God, the Word of God rightly divided and rightly administered and applied. You can hear the Word of God preached and taught academically, but Paul was sowing into people because he knew that there were wolves among them that would twist Scripture, and Paul stressed the importance of teaching the whole counsel of the Word of God and not like those who would distort the Scriptures. We also looked at shepherding was a declarative presentation, not only a teaching presentation, but Paul's mind and heart, he was an ambassador in chains. He was given a message. He was given a call. He was given marching orders, if you would. And so it's not about fulfilling our agenda or how we deem ministry ought to be. You know, we're trying to invent ways to hook people or to bring a gimmick. And we get all those kind of understandings from the world. And that's the problem with the Church of the Living God in our generation, is that we look too much like the world. You hear what I'm saying this morning? We look too much like the world. We should never apologize that the Word of God is sufficient to complete and minister to the whole person. The Word of God is sufficient. We need to trust it. We need to preach it. We need to declare it. And when Paul declared the Word of God without compromise, also in Acts chapter 20, he said he was an ambassador in chains with a message to go throughout Ephesus preaching the gospel. He saw it as a royal decree given to him by the king. Oh, the message of the gospel is the only power of God unto salvation. Not your persuasion, not your twist on it, not trying to convince other people. You need to trust it and to believe it and to declare it and to live it. And to proclaim it is what Paul did. And this is what occurred, and you can read it in the 20th chapter again, not taking time to do that. But Paul didn't merely share the gospel or teach the gospel. He declared it, and the whole city of Ephesus was impacted, turning from idolatry to Christ. Do you believe today that God's Word has an impact? Do you believe that this morning? Well, if you believe that it has changed your heart, you need to know that it will have an impact where you live and where you work and where you reside. And we need to share it. We need to share it unashamedly. We need to share it where it might be something where we might not always get it right or where we feel awkward in doing so. But sharing it and being obedient to Christ will bring blessing. We just need to trust that it is the power of God unto salvation. And so Paul goes on in this 20th chapter, verses 18 and 20. Not only did he shepherd in a doctrinal way, in a teaching way, not only did he shepherd in a declarative presentation without compromise. And by the way, you need not ever apologize for the gospel. You need not ever need to water it down. We don't have to decaffeinate the gospel that it might be accepted. You know, people who are struggling with the gospel of Jesus Christ, always remember it's their struggle. It's settled in your spirit. And that's why we don't go out with arrogance. We don't go out with jamming it down people's throat. But we believe that we are to communicate God's word in love so people can grow up into Christ, who is the head of the church. We don't need to repel people with a message that is supposed to attract people. And so present it the way it is. You know, you don't need to put it in your framework or in certain ways of presentations to make it more effective. It has been proven. It has passed the acid test. It will do what God ordained it to do. And so we need to share it. But the third way in which he shepherded was personally. And in two places in that 20th chapter, as we looked at last week, he did not shrink back, the Bible said. He said, when you review my time with you in Asia, he said, remember, I was with you all the time. I was with you all the time. I wasn't with you just on Sunday mornings. I wasn't just with you when it was convenient for me. It wasn't when it worked out for my schedule, but he said, and I did not cease to minister to you all the time with tears for the 3 years that I spent with you. For 3 years, weeping over these people, teaching them, instilling them, because he knew the wolves were coming. He knew that people were coming to steal away the joy that is in the hearts of believers and try to get them back under the law again and ceremonial law to measure up to God. And we can have that tendency too, can't we? To be prone to a performance orientation of God's word. You know, it's like, yeah, I know God saved me. I know salvation is through the Christ and him alone and his word. But then we live as if it was dependent on us. Let me share with you. God is far more important than we could ever be to satisfy God. The sacrifice has already been made. We need to be living honorably unto Christ because of what he's accomplished for us. And so Paul shepherded in a personal way, not just academically, if you would. He gave up, read the text, he gave up personal comfort to tell other people about God's saving grace, verse number 24, and he admonished the church at Ephesus and the Ephesians there with tears for those 3 years that he spent with them, personally pursuing people in the ministry of the word. I was sharing with Dave. We were walking down the hall of the church between sessions, you know, and I don't even remember the context. And, you know, it just kind of dawned on me. I was thinking there, you know, sometimes we're so concerned about our image. We're so concerned about our position or our status or what other people think about us. I think we need to spend more time being concerned about being conformed into his image and upholding his image instead of worrying about what other people think about us. Hey, folks, the days are drawing short. We need to be more concerned that people see Christ in us, the hope of glory. We decrease as he increases. The bottom line, people do not need to see us. They need to hear the voice and heart of God's Spirit through what we share. And that's his message, not ours. And every church leader you need to pray for. And somebody told me this morning, Ron, I pray for you. And I said, yes, I know that. I sense that. I realize that. I experience your prayers in a way in which it's lived out for sustainability and faithfulness. And so your prayers for these who teach God's word, and these prayers for those who stand in the gap, those who are confronted with various situations from many different people at many different times and phone calls, I pray that you pray for me that I would have God's wisdom, that I would have the mind of Christ to convey not what I think about a situation or a way in which I think you can resolve a problem, but bringing you to the heart of God. What does His Word say about it? May that be on the lips of your spiritual leaders. You know, what God has to say about it. We can have things to say about it all day long, you know, and everyone has an opinion, but we need to be magnifying Him by trusting in His Word and carrying it out and applying it in every circumstance. And so I hope that you're encouraged by what you hear today, because, you know, going to conferences and all those kind of things, they're wonderful, but we need not to take that as an academic exercise, but to see how those things apply and how they can make us even better for the purposes of God, and to be open to the leading of His Spirit. And we all need to have a teachable spirit, folks. We need to have a hunger for God, a thirst for God, just what Jim was singing this morning. And thank you for that song, too, by the way, Jim. And Karen, God bless you. And you know what? I want to take one moment this morning. Now, I'm going to embarrass somebody, but, you know, Bertha Campbell, she's been through a whole lot, and she's back with us. And happy Mother's Day to you. We love you dearly, Bertha. God bless you. And we need to be there as a family of God for each other. And, you know, by really being there for each other, you care about, like the Apostle Paul conveyed by way in which he shepherded. We can share the things that we're going through and the heartache and all that. And there's been a lot of that, you know, in our church over the years. But we need to also express that we're concerned and we care about how we walk according to the rule of Christ. How's your walk? How's your prayer life? How's your Bible study? And when people ask those kind of questions, you know, you might see them in a grocery store, and you know that person cares enough about you to ask that kind of question. I've been in that situation. I see so-and-so coming up the aisle, and I conveniently need something in another aisle, because I don't want to be asked that question too many times. But, you know, it's wonderful to be able to know, when I see you, you love me enough in Christ. Hey, what have you been getting out of God's Word lately? And we need to be concerned about people's spiritual walk. We can have our prayer meetings where they're organ recitals, you know, about my knee and aunt's bad leg and these kind of things. When you look at Paul and his presentation in shepherding, it wasn't so much about, you know, how you feeling today, fine, how you feeling, and then we go our way. So how things with Jesus in you these days, you know? And so those were kind of my takeaways from the conference, Eric and Dave. And, you know, lot to chew, lot to mull over. And, you know, it was just good to do that. And I came home, and I got to go to the Men of Courage breakfast with Frank Reich, who is the coach of the Indianapolis Colts up in Buffalo at the Hyatt yesterday. And what a wonderful week it's been, you know. And Frank Reich, you know, the no question about that invitation for salvation, right, Joel? And these Christian athletes, just a wonderful opportunity to see what God is doing. Nick Foles, by the way, he was the one that won the award, the Man of Courage Award, presented over these last several years by Frank Reich. They also, in Indianapolis, they started a sex trafficking ministry against all of these young people that have been absorbed into that situation, he and his wife and his daughters. And so, you know, pray for believers who are in these places of influence. You know, pray for believers that are daring to step out to make a difference, and just trusting God and believing His word enough that it is going to change things. You know, we live in a fallen world, don't we? We live in a very corrupt situation, and we see it deteriorating every day before our eyes. What a time for the church to stand up and be the church and preach the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? Well, who's up to bat? Eric, Dave, don't be polite, just come on down.
Dave didn't move, so I guess it's me. Huh? Good morning, everyone. Happy Mother's Day as well. I wanted to, as an aside, not from the conference, but just wish Happy Mother's Day to mothers who have their children with them and who don't. So a lot of you may have lost. We've lost in the past, and or miscarried, or some have lost your mom just recently. So know that He loves you. He comforts you, and He is near you, and He's a good God, and you can trust in Him. And we love you, and we are thankful for what you do. It is a very difficult role that God calls you to. I know I couldn't do it without my wife. I wouldn't know what it would be like to not have my wife with my kids, and so I'm appreciative. So I just wanted to say that. So first of all, I guess this week was, I didn't really have any particular expectations. I've been to conferences before, but this conference was something where I actually got to go with my best friend, and then I got to meet Dave and Ron there as well. And so we took the trip down there, and my friend's like, hey, what do you want God to do in your heart this week? What do you want to learn? And I was like, honestly, I don't know. I just know I want Him to, you know, show me who He is more, and maybe just learn a few different things and see how they run church. And then I realized, you know, over the course of the couple days, the biggest thing I realized and remembered is just how refreshing it is to be with the Lord by myself and then around others. So there was, like Ron said, probably 1,700 to 2,000 different men there. And sorry, Dave, if I steal this, but we'll probably overlap each other, as Ron said. But there's something about when men in the church sing, women sing beautifully. But when men sing, because they're leading from the front, it makes a difference. And so the booming voices of pastors and missionaries and elders and others just praising Christ and lifting Him up, and the songs, hopefully we're going to implement some of those here, were so centered on Him, and it causes you to worship, not because of the emotion of the song, but because of the words in the song, and that they correspond to His word, which is how it should be. And so that really just refreshed my heart, being able to sit under that. And then as far as the teaching, so Alistair Begg, who sounds a little like Shrek, he's got a really cool voice, and there was John Woodhouse and Tony Marita, who's a pastor who at a seminary that I graduated from. A thing I got from it is they're very humble. So in the Christian scene, these guys would be like rock stars, right? Alistair Begg's got this huge radio show. The church is, I don't know, what, 4,000, 5,000 people? Everyone wants to know his advice and his opinions and his ideas on these scriptures and these situations and scenarios. And they would come out, we did a Q&A session, and they're like, you know what? I don't know. Like, this is what I've learned. This is what I would see in God's word. You know, this is my opinion. But it was a very humble position. And it just reminded me that as leaders, as you know, as Ron speaks and Dave and I speak and others, we don't have all the answers. They struggle too. You know, I know one of Tony Marita. He's had some family issues in the past and things with his kids. And it was just nice to know that, you know, sometimes when you're maybe on stage and in front of people and you're teaching others, it's like, I got to know all the answers. Everybody expects and relies on me to teach God's word correctly. And we do our best, right? But we're broken and fragile and vulnerable people just like you. And, you know, I've always appreciated being a little bit younger, men in the faith who have stayed faithful. Alistair Begg, I think, is 70, and then John Woodhouse, I think, is in his mid-70s. And there's not a lot of guys, pastors nowadays, that remain faithful to the Lord to the end. And so seeing their example, seeing their humility. And then I think the third thing for me was seeing God's word come clear to me even more. I was thinking of, if I can turn to it here, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, it says, "And when I came to you, brothers, did not come proclaiming to the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling, and my speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith may not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." And I thought about that. Paul, who's, you know, like the Pope back then, right? He knows everything, and he's like this mega Christian. He said, "I'm weak. I don't have all these articulate words and these philosophies, and I'm trying to debate with you. I have a simple message. It's Christ and him crucified." Sometimes we overcomplicate it. Sometimes we try to think of ways around it. Or when we come to Christ, we get saved. We pray and ask Jesus to change our hearts, and then we kind of leave it. But the cross is essential for everything. And I think the thing that the Lord was teaching me is just you cling to that. Like, you cling to my word. Your marriage needs my word. Your parenting needs my word. Your neighbors need my word. My coworkers need his word. You all need his word. And one of the pastors, John Woodhouse, said, when the Bible says the word of the Lord says, it's going to happen. Like, you cling to it. Like, when he says something, it's God saying it. That's his promises that he's giving to us. So it's going to happen. So we can take it to heart, and we can apply it to our lives, and we can rest in it and trust in it because it's his word. Sometimes I think in America, we take it for granted because we have full access to his word, right? I have, what, like 7 to 8 Bibles in my house. Probably many of you have multiple different Bibles. I know there was missionaries in Saudi Arabia who did a breakout session, and they're just longing for translations of the Bible in their language to minister to Muslims, right? So people don't even have access, so we have it at our disposal at all times. So how often are we reading it? How often are we studying it? And then how often are we applying it? God's word isn't just meant to be read to have knowledge, but it's meant to live out. And I think more than anything, with just different things going on in my family and on my work and struggles and things that we have personally, God is really calling me to rest in him. And I think this was a good week to be refreshed, to just hear that he loves me, to experience the praises of his people. It was a great time with Dave and Ron just to have some lunches together and conversations about there we go. My booming voice is back. So in all that said, I guess this morning, just to encourage you all, just to tell you, God loves you, and he gave up his life for you. He is the answer. All of the yeses are his, and he holds everything together. You don't need anything else. You don't need a self-help book. You don't need someone's personal experience, opinion of someone who's a scholar or a PhD. You need Christ. You need his word, and he's going to be your hope. So wherever you are, marriage-wise, work-wise, health-wise, cling to him. Know him intimately. Spend time with him. Be in his word. Be refreshed in him, and he changes your heart, and that's what matters more than anything. So, Dave, you're up next. You want me to do a fill in here while you walk down the aisle, or?
There's nothing left. Not really. It was just such a refreshing week, and you just had to be there. Tim, I don't know, we want Tim to play that video for us. It's just a little sample of some of the worship that we went through, and I got to tell you, as Eric and Pastor said, when you get into a room with 1,700 men, I mean, you ladies have a beautiful voice, and you sing wonderfully, but there's something about guys singing, men, and I think there was, like you said, 1,700 or 2,000 men there singing, and just want to share a little clip from that for you.
All people that on earth do dwell, sing to the Lord with cheerful voice. Serve Him with joy, His praises tell. Come now before Him and rejoice. No.
Pastor and I talked about, we got to get this men of praise and women of praise going again. Remember how we used to do that? That's great. But those worship times during the conference were very, very special and very moving. As I thought about, we thought about the name of the conference. It's called Basics 2022. And I think it was Tuesday morning, Alistair shared with us some of the scriptures that Eric read out of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And the reason that they called it basics, you know, in business and in sports, you hear a lot of times when teams and businesses are struggling, the leadership will say, you know, it's time to get back to basics. And we forget sometimes as leaders and pastors that we need to be to reaffirm the basics that we know and the purpose that we have in God's program. And as you read through the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, you know, God's purpose and God's program repeats itself over and over again. And Alistair pointed out that, you know, we just don't have to be old to forget. I don't know about anybody here, but you know, I struggle with my memory a lot, and it's not getting any better, right? But we come Sunday after Sunday, and I know we're a people that we like new and exciting things, and that's good. You know, God provides that. But to remember some of the basics and just to reaffirm, you know, what we know to be true about God is just so important, isn't it? And so that was, you know, the theme of the conference. And Eric shared that verse out of that portion of scripture in 1 Corinthians. And Paul said, "For I am determined to know nothing about you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." And that was really the theme and the repeated theme of the conference. And as Pastor shared this morning, that all roads really lead to Christ. And as a church, we really need to be unified in the gospel message. And we can find so many reasons to gather and so many different needs. But it really comes down to the gospel, doesn't it? And I know a couple weeks ago, Pastor shared about the importance of the gospel, just not for salvation, but as we live out our faith in Christ and to remember what he did and what is available to us through the gospel. I'll close with this. I remember, I think it was in the question and answer period, there was a couple of them, and somebody asked a question, got up and asked a question to Alistair, and they said, "You know, as a pastor and as a leader in the church, we faced a lot of different situations in the past couple of years, and how do we address those as leaders and pastors in a church? How do we address, you know, the pandemic? How do we address the sickness? How do we address the church with the end times?" And I love his answer because it made you think. He said, "Fly the airplane." You remember that? He said, "Fly the airplane." He said, "You're going to run into turbulence." He said, "Fly the airplane and follow the instruments." And I think that's a real challenge for all of us as leaders, ministry leaders, just attendees here in the church. The message is the same. The purpose is the same. And again, all roads lead to Christ. And it was a great opportunity to be there. We established some really good fellowship with some people of like precious faith. I think we had dinner the other night with a man from Nigeria. Yeah, we met a lot of people. There were people there from all over the world. And the man shared how God had made a way for him and his wife and children to come, and then made a way for him, his father, I think, and mother to be here and for him to get medical treatment. But there was a lot of fellowship that we enjoyed with people like Precious Faith. So it was a great opportunity. If you get the chance, just go online and type in Basics 2022, and it'll take you to some of the sessions. And it'll be a nice thing to spend an evening instead of Netflix. Spend an evening with your family watching some of those. Those are really encouraging. So, again, we appreciate the opportunity to go and the opportunity to share this morning.
When the guys were singing there in the presentation this morning, I thought I could almost see Eric and Dave over there singing in that clip, but I might be wrong. But anyway, we had a wonderful time, and I leave you with this morning as we close in prayer. Go ye therefore into all the world, church, and declare the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's stand as we close in prayer. Father God, we thank you for the freedom of the declaration that we can voice and live and carry out as the Apostle Paul shared by way in which he did it, not ceasing to shed tears. As even Jesus did, looking over Jerusalem, he wept. Father, may we weep. May we weep over our community. May we weep over our family. May we weep, Lord, but may we weep with hope. Oh, hear the gospel, hear its saving message. Be compelled to respond to this joy that can be yours eternally and internally. Father, we thank you for the preaching of the cross. thank you for the teaching of your word. We thank you for the personal way in which you is embodied by the Spirit within each heart of every believer. Lord, send us. May our feet be precious to you as we go, Father, into all the world. Lord, bless this ministry as we refresh our minds and hearts with the theme of why we do what we do. It's because of Jesus and him crucified. Father, Paul was one of the most highly educated of his day. But Father, he determined to know among all those people that he had influence with to share the gospel as being the priority. For there is no other message under heaven, no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. And that name is Jesus. We love you. Send us forth with hope, with the message to declare, with the message to live. And Father, we thank you with expectant hearts that you will give us every opportunity to do that which is important in a world that seems so filled with that which is urgent. Father, may that be the priority of your church. We love you. We praise you. We thank you for your eternal word that changes our lives to conform us more and more into the image of Jesus. We love you and praise you, and all God's children said, amen. God bless you, and have a wonderful afternoon.